Hello, everyone, and welcome to the 9 a.m. session in the developer and open source track. As a reminder to our in-world and web audience, you can view the full conference at the conference.opensimulator.org and tweet your questions and comments to @OpenSimCC with the hashtag OSCC14. This hour, we are happy to introduce a terrific session called Dynamic Virtual Environments, Possible New OpenSim-Based Approaches. Our speaker today is Vitaly Chashin, the Technical Director of Intech IND LTD, which is a leading software developer of open source community Triality. He received his undergraduate degree in physics from Moscow State University and the University of Liverpool, where he received his MSc in IT with a master's thesis on the use of virtual agents in the OpenSim environment. Welcome all, and let's begin the session.
Good morning, and thank you for attention for your attention to my presentation. First of all, a few words about myself. I am working with OpenSim since 2008, and as San said, now I'm a technical director of Intech Limited. The main activity of this company is OpenSim-based 3D solutions. Also, I am a leading software developer of Triality community, which is focused on open source, OpenSim, and OpenSim client development. This presentation is a result of our work during the last 3 years. Let's start from some theory. It's very simple, but it gives an idea what this is all about. If we will look closer at OpenSim ecosystem, we'll see that there are two points of view on the whole program complex. Let's call it a developer and scripter points of view, and they are different. The developer knows how the client and server works in details. He could imagine what is OMV protocol. He knows about various parts of client and server and their interactions. But the virtual environment itself is a bit abstract for him. He thinks in categories of protocol, client, server, and their modules, and knows how do they form the picture on the screen. But that's why the picture the scripter sees all in a different way. For him, the virtual world is the main part. He sees object on the scene and the interaction, and thinks in categories of scene and objects. He may know nothing about the protocol, and the client for him is a kind of black box, because he can't do much about it, because HUDs are parts of scene too, actually. If we'll try to put it all together, we'll see a few classes or categories of developers working with OpenSim. First of all, core developers who works on case services, scene code, OMV protocol, etc. I would put in this category of developers, client developers too. They also know very good how everything works. Then we have server extensions developers. They're making regular modules, additional services, etc., and they also know the architecture well. And then we have the scripters. First two categories have a developer point of view. They think in terms of protocol. Scripters think in terms of scene, but the possibilities are limited. It seems to me that there is a missing link or level, you name it, between these developer categories. This is a developer who can create full-scale applications in the frame of OpenSim, but at the same time, he could think in terms of scene. In this presentation, I would like to discuss a possibility of creation of this thing. Let's see what we may need for this. Let's start from the modular structure of OpenSim, which allows to extend scripter possibilities. There are a number of ways to do this. Region modules, direct API extension, for example, OSCC API or OSSL API. Adding a new .NET languages extension allows us to do this modern work, but all of this is not descriptive work. Usually, the region modelers or core developer do this work. And as a rule, by very specific script requests. That's why this progress is this process is actually endless. New VSL functions could be added and added and added. I suggest to look at the situation from the other side. When do we need to stop? Which set of possibilities is enough? To answer that question, I propose our definition of virtual application and dynamic virtual environment. So, virtual application is a program unit of virtual environment fully independent from client-server realization and network protocol application, which have a full access to programming language standard library, an ability to use dependencies, and full access to client and server methods. A good analogy of virtual application is a program in a modern multitasking operating system. It could use all possibilities of the programming language, fully self-contained, and depends only on realization of standard libraries of programming language and operating system. So we gave a definition. Let's see what's necessary for realization of such conception. First of all, we need a truly modular client, in other words, client-side plugins. Second, we need a possibility to use a full-scale .NET language in server scripts. Third, for many reasons, we need a possibility to use precompiled assemblies as server scripts. Most of this is required to create a complex project with various dependencies. And at last, it would be good to reuse as much code as possible from all sources, client, server, and libmv, just not to reinvent the wheel. And now, I'll try to tell what we have done already. But please remember that all of this is only a very raw prototype, which requires a lot of additional work, testing, and discussion. Many of our solutions may be far from the best. Let's start from the server part. What we see on the screen is a classic LSL script. It has good sides and bad sides. Good are state meshing and overall simplicity. Bad sides are the absence of classes, an entertaining quest about arrays, and more. And the main problem is that it's in some degree of complexity, due to global variables and many other things, our script became a crystal pure example of spaghetti code, which is very difficult to read, test, and refactor. So let us try something more interesting. And this is the same script in C#. It looks quite similar, but a bit longer. This is not an OpenSim C#. We have the class and the namespace here. Actually, this is OpenSim script on some stage of code generation, which is usually hidden from the scripter. But the difference between LSL and C# scripts seems not very large at this moment, and it's unclear what it gives for us. Let's go further. This is more interesting. It's a work with class in script. What we did, we defined a very simple class and wrote a couple of methods for it. These methods we could use in main script, and by passing to a constructor of our class main script instance, we could use standard methods in our class. There could be a question about the state serialization of such script, and I'll say a few words about it later. But we have a new problem. It's very inconvenient to work with such code in a default client script editor. That's why we propose an integration with Xamarin Studio. Xamarin opens our script as external editor and provides code highlighting and autocomplete. How it works? We have a template of solution and necessary dependencies on client side. When we want to open our CUDA, the client creates a temporary Xamarin project. The next idea. Why we could not have a standard library of such classes for simplification and standardization? Here we see the CSHost class, which is actually a wrapper on a well-set print something. This class is not serializable because it requires a full initialized LSL API. That's why we implemented overridable method initGlobals, which works on script deserialization. We could init such classes in this method. And to finish the server sim, there are two new asset types. First is a generic file. Actually, it's a blob without any properties. It could be used for an invert file exchange because its only function in inventory is to download it. But it's mostly a template, which we will need further. And the second type of assets is a precompiled script. When it's placed to the prim inventory, it starts like a usual script. Also, it could be used as a dependency for other scripts. We haven't completed it yet, but first tests were successful. That's all about server side. Let's move on. And let's talk about client. We'll start from one thing, which is a bit of topic to virtual application sim, but gives some new possibilities. This is shared media controllers. What is it? Imagine that HTML, which sources on the left, displayed on a prim's side. We'll see two buttons, up and down. JavaScript code, which runs by click on them, could send a message to script in this prim. It's on the right side. The next is obvious. By pressing these buttons, the prim moves. We also added an opposite message. A script could tell something to HTML page. It could work not only for HTML in a prim, but for HTML in user interface too. We also added a basic synchronization for media plugins, which allows some very basic co-browsing. This extends the scripter possibilities, but as I told, a bit of topic to virtual application. This could be used in LSL and does not require plugins on client side. So let's move on. For plugins on client side, we decided to embed Mono runtime. Minimal size of runtime is about 10 megabytes, and it's quite satisfactory. We made one main assembly, which realizes interaction with client functions, unmanaged code. Also, it defines the plugin interface, a few simple methods, and on a client start, it's search for DLLs, realizing such interface in the plugins folder, trying to load them and register in the system. LibOMV code is actively reused in the process. We'll see this later. But first, let's discuss the main problem of a plugin, which is what is necessary to realize. First, we have to bind plugin with the main message protocol. We need to track in and out packets and react on them and have an ability to send such packet from plugin. Second, we need to provide an interaction with client interface, client UI, user interface. This includes an ability to read and set user interface values of user interface controls to track messages from them and to add new elements from plugin. Third, we need to provide some connection with client internals. We could not do everything just by sending a packet in a frame of protocol. Let's see what we have done already. So, message system. If you are familiar with grid proxy from libOMV, it will be clear for you. There is no actual proxy in our realization. Plugin passes the message name to client, and the client subscribes it to this message. When the client have this message, it passes the message to the plugin as a row byte array. Next is simple. We are using libomv to serialize, deserialize the packet and to work with it then. We have not realized yet packet modification like in grid proxy, but it will be done soon. The sample is on the screen, the code, the sample code for the plugin. Packet injector works in the same way. We create packet, serialize it into byte array with libomv, and pass it to client. So that's all with messages, and next is client interface. If you want to work with a client control from plugin, you have to give it an unique GUID in interface description. By a change of such control, a message on control will be sent to plugin, and you can get or set value of control by this GUID. It may be a bit cumbersome, but I think that it could be extended and simplified by a new project type for Visual Studio or Xamarin. We could create a graphical user interface editor, and with some code generation, we could simplify the process to WinForms variants. So you draw a button, double click it, and you got your the handler in code. Also, we added an ability to create and register a new floater and to register an XUE command handler. Well, the code shows how it works and it's simple enough. And the last point is client internals. Of course, we just have no time to create mono bindings to all client functions. But as it seems to me, it's not necessary from architecture point of view. Most of things we need are in a few singletons in new view projects, such as gAgent, gAvatar, and so on. They're singletons, and because of that, we could easily bind the methods to mono via static wrappers. An example is on the screen. It would be very good to define what functions we need to bind in such way, but I believe that it's possible only on open development and testing stage. So we just created a few bindings to test the conception. Client. And now let's see what we have in FHO. We have two types of projects, client plugin and server assembly. Both have really wide possibilities, but they are two different projects. And it's not a virtual application because we have to think in terms of message exchange between them, in terms of protocol. So what we can do about this? A lot. Let's start from the realization of the interface to server assemblies in our main script. This gives us a possibility to find the client by UID, unique identifier, and to call some client-side methods from server script. The sample is on the screen. Then, let's define a call to a specific server script from client plugin. To do this, we'll implement the method, which allows to register a script as interacting with plugin. Let the script be registered with exact name and unique ID. Then the client enters to the scene, it receives a list of such scripts. Then we can find the necessary script in a plugin and pass a direct message to it. Now we are at the process of realization of the opposite operation, a message from a server script to exact client plugin. This is a bit better than separate plugin and server script, but we still have message exchange here, and we want to hide it from scripter. They're looking at this problem, and the next slide is some ideas about it. We need code generation here, and that's why a new project type for Xamarin or Visual Studio. It would be good to have three project types: a client plugin, server assembly, and application, which is both of them together. It would be good to have a user interface designer, as I have told before. Maybe it would be possible to create some testing environment for debugging of such projects. Then we could use a code generation, for example, by attributes. We could mark some methods in a server script and in a client plugin by a specific attribute, and generate a code which allows us to call it directly from the opposite side, like VCF or other web services, you know. So, and combine that with file asset type, and you have ability to send a plugin installer to the client from server script on some event. And this all is very close to our definition of virtual application. And conclusions. Of course, such project has a lot of problems, even if we don't take in account that the current realization is a prototype, code is dirty, not covered by tests, and so on. I'll try to name some of them. First of all, it's a security problem. Client plugins are dangerous because the source is closed. The source is closed. But server assemblies are much more dangerous, even if they run in a sandbox, because they could crash the server. The aspects of security are very serious, and I think it requires an open discussion. Second is performance. Mono calls and marshalling could be a problem here. We need tests and measurements. Third is hypergrid. I have no experience with hypergrid code, so I could not imagine the problems here, and I suggest this as a point for open discussion too. So, conclusions. We may have a full-scale model client. We could even move some parts of a standard user interface to managed code. Full-scale server-side programming language. An ability to create a standard library to unite them. Visual Studio Xamarin could be used for projects and development. In future, we may have a virtual application by its definition. Also, it should be noticed that plugins and server assemblies are not under LGPL BSD license, like the core code. They could be distributed on commercial base. For example, I think it's possible to create some kind of plugin market. This was not the goal of our development, but as it seems to me, it could help for a popularization of OpenSim in general. And finally, I would like to say a few words about the history of this project. In 2009, we started work on the project for aviation personal English training in Aeroflot Russian Airlines. This was a continuation of implementing distance learning in Aeroflot. I was a leading developer. Project assumes wide using of agents or bots in a training process. And the aspects of the projects made it really difficult to realize by OpenSim standard tools. Bots were used for role-playing games and demonstration of a typical situation. And the bot scenario was really hard XML. We need some kind of visual editor for such scenarios bound to OpenSim, and an ability to start the scenario for demonstration, and an ability to change one or many bots to students. And also the ability for a teacher to get the control of each bot at each scenario step. Well, the system should be tightly integrated with Moodle, Airbus, LMS, and internal ERP services of Aeroflot. Some of them are really old legacy. And bots needs voices, which was realized on text-to-speech, and there was many other difficulties in this project. Well, in a whole, all of this could be done by a standard OpenSIM approach, OSL server modules, but it was really hard. That's why we started to extend the client abilities, the client and server abilities, and in time we understood that it could form some concept, and it was a concept of a virtual application. The project for Aeroflot was successfully realized, and now it's widely used in Aeroflot. It's used in Aeroflot, and in current moment, it's and its extension is assumed and planned in Aeroflot. So that was I missed the slide. If you have any questions, then please mail me to WCHF and Yandex.ru. Currently, there is no open repositories for our code for some reasons, because the code is a prototype, and as it seems to me, this code could be dangerous in griefer hands. It would be really simple to write some griefer plugin. But if you are a developer and you are interested in this code, then just please mail me and I'll give you the link or send you the code in some other way. We also set up a sandbox where you can test and try the we can try all of the abilities of our client and server. There will be a link on Triality community site, which is on the screen, iTriality room. I think the sandbox will be complete on Monday. So if we have some time. If we have some time, I can try to show a video of our Aeroflot project. One moment. If I can find it. Yes, this should be. A video. So you can click to play it, and this is play a game with our bots for Aeroflot Russian Airlines. Well, maybe we have time for a few questions if someone wants to ask something.
I don't know if you saw, we had one question in local chat, Vitaly. Asked, why is C sharp bad for scripting?
I don't think that C sharp is bad for scripting. I think quite the opposite. It's much better than ever so.
Can you also provide the link for the video that was up there in case folks weren't able to get it to play in world?
Yes, one moment, please.
Thank you, Vitaly.
One moment. Yes. One moment.
Is that the Expo virtual link that you gave before the conference? I can drop
it
in.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
It's that link. Yes. The question is, what operating system did you embed Mono in the client side? Currently, our client is Windows 64-bit. We have Linux. We have a Linux variant too, but time because there are actually 2.5 developers in our community, and I am not familiar with Linux. And a Linux developer is a half of developer. Does Mono facilitate making a secure sandbox for client-side scripting? Fine. I think you can rule out file system access and perhaps open arbitrary network connections. Yes, as far as I know, the Mono sandboxing is quite the same as .NET, so it could be controlled. Would a more traditional Lua or Squirrel make more sense? We tried Lua, so we tried scripting on Lua. We also tried JavaScript V8 engine. And yes, it works for scripts, but I think that we need an ability to distribute a plugin in compiler synthesis. So did you actively use the same C# code in shared DLLs on both client and server sides? Yes, it's one of main features and one of main ideas of a virtual application, to use the same code that I called standard library on a client and server side.
Do we have any more questions from the audience?
Compares with using something like JavaScript client side. Well, first of all, how do you think this compares with using something like JavaScript client side? The question is. Well, first of all, we can use JavaScript on a client side via shared media controllers. We could use an HTML as parts of a client interface, and it will interact with plugins, and it's simple. Second one, from our experience with Google V8 engine, with embedding it, I would say it's more difficult to bind JavaScript than to bind Mono. But it could be done, and I had an idea to use the JavaScript for user interface only, and Mono for other parts of plugins, but it's still not realized. Yes, of course. And how do you think this plays with what Krista was talking about this morning? Is there room for cooperation, do you think? Yes, I hope that there is a room for cooperation, and I really would like to finish this project and to discuss what can be done about it and to contribute its code to OpenSim. Can you elaborate on your statement that this paradigm might provide an opportunity for commercial ecosystem for plugins to OpenSim? Yes, because plugins are loaded dynamically, they are not under LGPA license for client. So the plugins itself and server-side assemblies could be closed source. It's not a violation of a license, I believe. Okay, any more questions? Looks like there's no more questions. So thank you for your attention, and please feel free to mail me if you have any questions. And visit our sandbox, which will be ready on Monday, and you can try our client and server. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Vitaly, for a terrific presentation. As a reminder to our audience, you can see what's coming up on the conference schedule at conference.opensimulator.org. In this room, the next session will be Virtual Worlds on a Web Browser with Tony Alatalo at 10 a.m. Thank you again to our speaker and to the audience, and we'll be back shortly with the next session.
Yes, one moment, please. It should be next. Oh yes, this one. Thank you. Mm-hmm.